It's not about us. In this powerful study, we're checking the vital signs of our spiritual life to see where we are and how we are in Christ Jesus. And today, we're going to learn that Christianity, it's not about us. Sometimes we think it might be, but really it's not. Every ability that God gives us today is meant to return glory to God. I want you to listen specifically today to this time in the Word and this message today, because we're dealing with today believers, we're dealing with worship, we're dealing today with issues pertaining to our relationship with God, that I think so many times people literally miss what it's all about. And so I pray today that your heart will be blessed by the Word today. True believers understand the whole world is a sanctuary where we seek to bow our knee, and we today bow our knee and give praise to Jesus Christ. But we do that in every area of our living. It's just not a Sunday thing or Wednesday thing. It's just not an occasional thing. It should be an everyday thing in our life that we are bringing worship before the Lord. A lot of people think, well, we only worship when we go to church. Well, that's partially true. You worship God all the time, every day. So for the Christians, worship is not just something that we do in this place. It's something that should be a vital part of our living every day. And also, it's amazing what God does through worship, how He touches hearts, how He saves the lost, how He heals the sick, how He encourages the discouraged, how He lifts up, how He touches. Oh, it's amazing that when we get in the true area of worship, what God will do in the lives of His people today. For the Christian, worship is the way that we live our lives. That should be a daily thing, as I said earlier. So it's the way that we live our lives today. The vital sign today that I want to talk about this morning is the reality that real Christians live for God's glory rather than living for our own glory. See, you've got to understand glory and you've got to understand worship. And that's what I'm going to try to bring to your attention today, that you will have a better understanding. I'm going to tell you, when you understand worship better, you'll understand how to glorify God. You'll understand how God is honored in our living every day. And so we are to lend our hearts today to worship. Our worship today is pointed to and focused upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's done in every situation of every day of our living. It's just not when we're feeling good we worship God. You worship God through the trials. You worship God through the valleys. You worship God through the victories. You worship God in all things. And so realizing this, it's not about getting anything from God. You know, a lot of people have the perception, well, I go to church and I worship God. Well, I actually go to get. Well, I'm going to dispel that myth today because it's wrong. We do not today worship God to get. We worship God to give more of ourselves to Him. And so it's important that we give totally, completely, and surrender all. Yeah, but preacher, I give God a little bit of my time each week. And if I get time, I even read the Bible and I pray a little bit. That's not acceptable. God wants all of you all the time. Amen. Now, when we're truly worshiping today, it will actually protect us today from living for ourselves. Because if we're not careful, we can get all about us. Numero uno, it's all about us. It's all about me, you know. We've got to be careful of that we don't get so hung up today in the world that it's all about us and that we insist on we want things that make us happy. Well, I'm going to tell you, when you get into a walk of worship and relationship and giving God glory, you're going to find that you're beyond happy. You're going to have the joy of the Lord in your life. And it's going to ring and resound the joy of the Lord in your heart every day, in every circumstance, and in every situation. Your life is not about living for yourself. Your life is about living for God. So the unfortunate truth is, though, today, many people worship to get from God rather than giving to God. So worship should be the first priority today for the believers, because when we really worship, God then becomes our primary, and He becomes today what our life is about, and everything about us then becomes secondary. And so it's getting the order right. It's getting God centered in our life. Jesus said something about this, didn't he, in Matthew 6, 33? Seek ye first the kingdom of God, his righteousness. And he said, all these things shall be added unto you. See, it's putting the Lord in the priority position, the focus of your life today. Now, here's some questions today for you to consider. Other than Sunday, do you regularly worship God? Well, preacher, we just do that in church. Better think about that. Second question, has the joy of your Christian life decreased significantly with time? Oh, you were so on fire when you got saved. You were so excited about the Lord when God touched your life and transformed you and made you his child. But that process of time, your heart's kind of gotten hard and your fire for God has kind of diminished some. Third question, do you repeatedly struggle today with the same sins in your life? You know, we just can't get victory over this particular sin. Well, worship is a part of you getting victory over sin. And if we will get the Lord in the position where we're worshiping him, our desires start to fade away. God starts to weed the garden of our heart out a little bit, getting those things out of our life that's not necessary. Well, let me give you another question today. Do you find it difficult to consistently read your Bible and pray? I just get so busy, preacher, you know. And folks, listen, we can come up with all the excuses why we don't serve or why we don't read and why we don't pray and why we're not in church. And we can come up with every idea and everything that we could conjure up. But really today, you know, it's all a matter of priority of where we're placing God. I got another one for you. Last question. Do you sense something that is missing in your relationship with God? Well, all these things that I just asked you today are contributive today to you losing relationship with God. See, God has not gone anywhere. He is still the same yesterday, today, and forever, isn't he? But we drift from God by getting our attention off of the Lord. So if you, well, in all these questions, I'm not going to ask you to lift your hand, but if you answered yes to just even one of these questions today, then, you know, this message is for you. You need to listen to what I'm going to share with you this morning because I want to help you. And I want today to draw your attention to the Lord. I think the greatest need today in the church today, including this church today, is that the church return to worship. I'm afraid that we have drifted away, and I'm just not talking about our church, I'm talking about church in general. I believe that the church of the Lord Jesus Christ has drifted away from the quality of worship, the priority of worship, the value of worship today. The heart of worship recognizes today that who we are in light of who he is. So you've got to understand who he is in order to understand today who you are. And so realizing this, we should exalt the Lord in our lives and in our church. Well, I found this. If I will exalt the Lord in my life, he will be exalted in the church. He will be magnified and he will be worshiped today. So what is the one evidence today of spiritual life? That's a question for you. It is to worship God in all things. Well, I just worship him when things are going good, but it's hard for me to worship him when I'm not doing so well and I'm in the valley and I'm going through a sickness and I've got a trial facing me, and it's hard for me to really worship the Lord. That's when you need to worship him. And so we are to worship God in all things at all times. That is crucially important for our life. True believers will live for God's glory rather than living for their own glory. So it's a matter today of putting our focus and our attention upon the Lord. Now, there are three realities this morning I want to share with you that remind us of the heart of true worship. And the first one today, and let's look at the verse first, in 2 Corinthians 3:18, this one single verse today has a very potent, powerful message for us. Paul, writing to the church at Corinth, he said this, "But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." Hallelujah. The first point today in this study is this. The heart of worship remembers our life's privilege is to receive Christ. And I tell you, it's the best thing that ever happens to your life when you receive the Lord as your personal Savior. It's a privilege to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. A privilege. I'm glad God extends that privilege to us today. I'm glad that His Word says all that will come to Him, He will in no wise cast out. And so there are two phases in verse 18 that reminds us today that it is a privilege to receive the Lord. Paul said, with open face beholding. So, and then Paul tells us, we are beholding the glory of the Lord. So he says, with open face we behold Him. We see Him as He is. We worship Him. We adore Him. And then he says that we are beholding the glory of God. Oh, we'll see that when we get to heaven, right? No, you can behold the glory of God right now. In this place today, if you will separate yourself from yourself, the world, and everything else, you can behold the glory of God. Hallelujah. So how can we see God? Through Jesus Christ. Well, I think today the Word is a good way today to describe it in John 1:14. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. In the person of Jesus Christ, you see God. Hallelujah. Well, how did I see Jesus? What is this called? This is called the Bible, isn't it? It is called the Word of God. Who is it about? It's about God's Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. 66 books about Him. You behold Him by the measure of this book. And when you receive this book, oh, hear me, when you receive this book and you are in this book and this book gets in you, you're going to see Him as He is. And you're going to worship Him. Hallelujah. So today, through the person of Jesus Christ, is the glory of God available. And this is not just a Sunday thing, but it's available when? Continually. All the time. Hallelujah. So if you know Jesus, then the veil has been removed today, and the glory of God is there, and you can see God for who He really is. And I think that's awesome today. So the veil has been removed. The veil is removed today in the process of salvation. Thank God we come into the presence of the Lord and He receives us and He makes us His child. We find in 2 Corinthians 3, it's also that we find the same thing in Exodus chapter 33 of what happened to the children of Israel. Moses was on Mount Sinai, you remember that, and he was meeting with the Lord. He was having time with God. And when he came off of the mountain, the people had committed a gross act of idolatry, which is sin. And you know what had happened. They were worshiping the golden calf, and they were worshiping that rather than Jehovah God. Now, Moses turned. He went back up the mountain on Mount Sinai, and once again, Moses met with the Lord. And Moses saw the glory of God. Hallelujah. It changed and transformed him. And beholding the glory of God, listen to what happened in Exodus 34, 29 and 30. It records this. And it came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai, and the two tables of testimony in Moses' hands, when he came down from the mount, that Moses wist not that the skin of his face shone while he talked with them. And when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, beholding the skin of his face shone, they were afraid to come nigh him. I'm telling you, the man was lit up. He was lit up because he had been in the presence of God. I'm telling you, when you are with God and you're in His presence, He will light you up. I mean, your countenance reflects the glory of God. Did you hear what I just said? You don't look like sour grapes. You reflect the glory of God. I mean, do people want what they see in you? You walk around and you look like, man, everything has gone wrong in your life. You're down, you're defeated, you're discouraged, you're sour grapes, and your attitude stinks. Do you think people are going to want that? Well, the glory of God's not on you. But when you today are in the presence of God, His Spirit is today going to touch you, and He's going to transform you. And today, He is going to shine in your life. Hallelujah. So, after speaking with them, the Bible says, Moses veiled his face. Hallelujah. In other words, the glory of God was covered. So Paul, reflecting on Exodus, he does this in 2 Corinthians 3. He's referring back to what happened to Moses and the children of Israel. Moses only got a glimpse of the glory, and he covered his face so the Israelites cannot look at it. Now, 2 Corinthians 3:13, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. This is where it gets good. Because what happened is Moses was in God's presence, but he was only there for a limited amount of time. And as a result, he reflected the glory of God, but listen to what was happening. It was fading. Now, because of Jesus Christ, Christians today abide in the presence of God, but hallelujah, it's not fading. It's forever. Praise the Lord. And the glory of God never fades. The glory of God never fades in your life. Hallelujah. There's evidence of eternal security there. There's evidence today of the power of God on your life. And folks, if this glory of God is on us and this glory of God is in us, then, you know, we should be reflecting this glory. We are the mirrors of the glory of God. So in Jesus, you get a glimpse of the glory and you can gaze at the glory, and sooner or later, you're going to become the glory of God. Amen. Now, why do we care about beholding the glory of God? Moses understood without the presence of God, it would be impossible to lead the children of Israel, to lead the children of God. So here's the bottom line today. Why we do care about beholding the glory of God. The bottom line is this. Moses, as well as us today, cannot do anything apart from God's presence. Remember, Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. But man, I'm glad he declares in Philippians 4:13, we can do all things through Christ, through him, which strengthens us. Praise the Lord. Can't does not exist in the vocabulary of the Christian when it comes to doing the work and the will of God. And so we today can't do anything apart from his presence. But man, when his presence gets in you and his presence gets on you, glory to God, you are a usable vessel to the glory of our magnificent and wonderful God. So Moses said in Exodus 33:18, you know what Moses said? He simply said these four words, show me thy glory. Amen. Show me your glory, God. It's God's glory that doesn't rest upon your life and upon our church. I'm going to tell you, if we don't have the glory of God on our church and in our lives, it's all for nothing anyway. But man, when the glory of God comes down and tabernacles with you, are you hearing what I'm saying this morning? I mean, when the glory of God gets in your presence, when the glory of God is revealed in your living, I'm telling you, it transforms you today. The church today is more concerned about substitutes than worship. Have you noticed that? We're living in a day of substitutes. And today we're living in a day, I was listening to a little television this morning as I was getting ready. And, you know, I just finally said, man, you're getting on my nerves. You're not telling me anything that I can use in my life that will enrich me. And this guy is well known and a noted preacher and a writer. And I've read some of his books, and his stuff's good, but I tell you, his preaching stunk this morning. Just to put it bluntly. We're not concerned about substitutes. Some of y'all use salt substitutes in your life, don't you? Some of you use sugar substitutes, don't you? But how many of you like the real thing? Yeah, all right. Praise the Lord. Well, I'm going to tell you, we in the church do not need to substitute the glory of God for things that do not honor and glorify him. We need today to put him first where he belongs, that he is glorified in all that we do. So what is the goal of worship then, Pastor? The goal of worship is to see God through his Son, Jesus Christ. That's what really the goal of our worship is all about. The heart of worship is that we see God for who he is. Now, the glory of God, it's the glory of God that saved us today. It's the glory of God that we need to live in a world that is so sinful. You need His mighty presence in your life every day. The privilege of Christianity is God Himself. It's a privilege to be a Christian. It's a privilege to be a child of God. Now, there are two options in our worship today that we have to consider, and you have to make a decision of where you are with these items. First, today, we can make worship all about ourselves. And unfortunately, today, that's what a lot of people do. We want God's gifts, but we don't want God. We want what God can give us, but we don't want the commitment that comes with that. Hello, y'all. That's dangerous. That's volatile today. Religion and rituals today become more important than a relationship. I wonder how many churches across our town this morning are more concerned about religion, which is man's way to God, and rituals, which is man's way to God, than concerned about a relationship of just letting God be God. Amen. The Bible says a veil is over their hearts. And I'm telling you today, the problem in our nation is, the fact is this, we've got a lot of nuts in Washington. They used to say the fruits and the nuts lived in California. No, I think they live in Washington now. But I'm telling you, that's not the problem. The problem is that there's a veil over the church. We have blinded today ourselves to the glory of God and the worship of God. And therefore today, we're just going through the motions and we're not experiencing God as He really is. Amen. The second area today of the options of worship is that we make it all about God. And that's what we seek to do in this ministry, in this church. That's what you need to do individually, is to make it all about God. Listen to what happens when we make it all about God. In 2 Corinthians 3:16, nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Amen. I'm telling you, when you turn to the Lord, the veil is going to be removed. And that's what's wrong with the church today. We're not turning to the Lord. We haven't gotten right with God. And there's a veil today. There's a separation. Thank God. I'm glad the veil of the temple was rent in twain when Jesus said, "It is finished," at the cross. And folks, we've got to remember today, anything that we put between us and God becomes a veil. It becomes a point of separation. When you stop living for yourself, you will then see God as He is, and the veil then is removed or taken away. It doesn't matter what ministries we're offering or what we do today. If God doesn't show up, it's not going to work anyway. You can have all the ministries in the world, but I'm going to tell you, if Jesus is not in the middle of it, it's not going to work. Amen. If God is not in your life today, your life will grow cold and your life will grow heartless today. You're just existing. And I'm really contending today, that's what's wrong with most Christians today. They're just existing. There's just breath in and out of their body, and that's about it. We don't need just the breath, man. We need the breath of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. We trivialize God today when our importance is more valuable today than His presence. There is nothing more important than our relationship with God. So the real question is not, what do we think worship is? The real question is, what does God think of us as we worship? I mean, is He pleased in what we do? Is He exalted in who we are? Authentic worship today is our attempt today to communicate to God how much, one, we admire Him. Second, today, how much we adore Him. And third, today, how much we appreciate Him. So you've got to get admiration, adoration, and appreciation, which I've said a gazillion times, brings about the process of fascination. You become absolutely fixed on Him. Nothing can break that fixation. Nothing can break that fellowship. Nothing can break that worship. Amen. What is going to intensify worship in our church is when you have Him before you, and you worship Him in the beauty of holiness today, and you worshiped Him before you got here. Amen. A lot of us think, well, worship starts when I get in the church, right? When I come sit down in the pew and we start singing Amazing Grace, that's when the worship begins. No, your worship should have began before you ever got here. Amen. So realizing this, what it's all about is, our God, He's an awesome God. But He wants to be awesome in your life. Don't come expecting God to give you anything. Come expecting to give God everything. Amen. I like the way that David put it in Psalm 29:2. He says, give unto the Lord the gift due unto his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Look beyond yourself and look to God today. You remember Ronald Reagan, President of the United States? He said, status quo is Latin for the mess that we're in. Amen. And I tell you what, that's exactly what status quo is. It's just staying in the mess that you're already in. I'm glad God's a God of deliverance. I'm glad His power can deliver us today from every difficulty in every situation. Ours is a mess when we can't grasp the reality today that worship, by its definition, begins with God, and we are to align ourselves with Him. Amen. Now let me give you the second one. Time's flying by. The heart of worship remembers our life's purpose is to reflect Christ. We reflect God's glory after we have worshiped Him. We reflect God's glory after we have worshiped Him. Paul said, with open face beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. Paul is saying, we behold His glory. Once we behold His glory, we then begin to reflect His glory. You can't reflect what you don't have. But once you've got it and it's revealed in your life, you can reflect it. Amen? So what does His glory do? It's very simple. I'll give it to you in basically four words. His glory transforms us. Did you hear that? What does God's glory do? It transforms us. What does it mean to transform? It means He changes you, amen. You're changed into His image. You're changed into His glory. You're changed into His presence. So Paul said, are changed into the same image from glory to glory. That means it doesn't stop. It's consistent. It continues today. The reflected glory of Jesus never fades in your life because the purpose is reflected through us. Now, we should reflect the glory of God like a mirror reflects. We should reflect the glory of God. And realizing this reflection is, and it's saying to the world, it's not about me. It's about Him. It's all about the Lord and what He is doing. Amen. We today are to build His kingdom, not ours. And we today are to magnify His name. So God does not bless you to compete with Him today. Understand this. He today blesses you today that you today can reflect Him and to declare how great our God is. Our life's privilege is to receive Christ Jesus. And today our life's purpose is to reflect the Lord Jesus. Let me give you the third one and I'm through. The heart of worship remembers our life's priority is to resemble Christ. To resemble means that we're patterned after or we're like Him today. Now, we're not Him, but we can today seek to be like Him. Hallelujah. We behold the glory of God. Therefore, what do? We reflect the glory of God. And when you reflect the glory of God, you actually become the glory of God. So is God honored today in this? Yes, He is. This is where it really gets good, and this is where God can really bless you. We're changed or we're transformed, and He said we do that through the process from glory to glory. So you're transformed to resemble Christ more and more every day. In other words, you're starting to empty yourself of you, and you're starting to fill yourself with Him. You're starting to realize life is not about you. Your life is about Him. And I'm going to tell you something today. When you get to that place, you're going to find that, man, God is one awesome God. You're going to find, whoo, He just doesn't meet my need. My Lord, He is good in every need that He supplies. Your praise starts to change. You start exalting Him. I mean, you got a spring in your step. You got a snap in your finger. You got a smile in your heart. I mean, something has happened. Amen. So we're changed, we're transformed today. Paul said in Romans 12:2, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed or changed by the renewing of your mind that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. So how are we transformed, Pastor? Very simply, we're transformed into the same image or the same representation today, into His glory. Has this happened? Have we changed? Has this transformation? Has this occur? It's all by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Do you realize greater is He that is within you than he that is within the world? I mean, He lives in you right now. He's with you right now. He's going to be with you when you leave. If you go to the far corners of the four corners of this earth, He's with you. You cannot escape His presence. Hallelujah. So today, that Holy Spirit is with us today. It happens on the inside, and it shows evidence on the outside. Amen. You don't have to, you know, say, well, we're church. Everybody put a smile on your face. Everybody in the car, y'all, we're going to church. Make sure when you go in, make sure you shake your hand, smile everybody. Make everybody think that, boy, you just filled with the Holy Spirit. You can put on that charade so long, and sooner or later, that charade is going to reveal who you really are. Serving God, worshiping the Lord, revealing His glory is not about a charade. It's about being who you are in Christ Jesus. Amen. So when you're focused on Him, here's what happens. The Holy Spirit starts changing us. Amen. It's a constant refining in our spirit. Well, I got saved so many years ago and I got all of God at that point. Yeah, but you got all of God, but has He changed you? Have you opened your life for Him to change you? Have you today given Him all the areas of your life that He can do this transformation today? Worship is our primary means of transformation because you throw off you and you take on Him. Praise God. Worship must be foundational. You can't build your life for Christ if you're not building on this foundation of worship that God is glorified in your living today. We come to God empty and thank God through His mercy and His grace. He fills us up. And it's a daily filling. Every day, every hour, every minute, He is filling us. Amen. Don't miss the priority of worship. Take the veil off and be a part of the miraculous that God is doing. Is God's glory more important than anything else in your life? It should be. If we today are not revealing Him, and we're only revealing us, you're still wearing the veil. You need to take the veil off and let God be glorified in your life. I believe it's time that we come back today to the heart of worship. I believe today if the church hears this message, just not our church, but every church would hear this message and realize that we come back to the heart of worship, that what is that worship about? It's all about Him. I believe that, bless God, there would be revival fires breaking out all across Lynchburg and all the surrounding area. I believe that there would be revival fires breaking out across our nation. All this sin that has invaded, I believe the fire of the Holy Ghost would burn every bit of that sin out. And we could come back and be a nation directly today under the inspiration and the leadership of Almighty God. You say, preacher, we've gone too far. Oh, no, we haven't. Because today, we're not walking on a street of gold yet. And we're not in heaven. And as you're going to hear a little bit later on today in the message, God is a God about second chances. I believe God can restore. I believe God can renew. I believe God can refresh. And I believe God can revive the nation of America. But I'm going to tell you, it's not going to happen until the church realizes it's all about Him. Amen. So this is the evidence today as we close out this session and we close out this series. This is the last message in this series today on vital signs. And I think it's a crescendo, if you would, of a way to end this series today is the fact that it's about the glory of God and it's about our worship to God. And may our worship, now what you've heard and received in here today, let it transform you and take it into the worship here in a few moments and watch God do a magnificent thing. It's going to be different. Amen. It's not going to be about the songs we sing. It's not going to be about us. It's going to be all about Him. and His glory is going to be revealed. Oh my God. Can you imagine if the Shekinah glory of God just enveloped this church and just came down and hovered in this place? Lord have mercy. It would be overwhelming. It would overtake you. And it would overbless you. And that's our desire today. We want you blessed so good. Hallelujah. You just can't be quiet about it. You just can't shut up about it. I mean, everywhere you go, you're talking about it. People say, what happened to you? I learned what worship was about. I learned who is the God of all worship. I learned about how He can be glorified. And that glory lives in me. And that He can be magnified and praised in all things today. I'm telling you, folks, that's the key to the church today. Let's not miss it. And let's let God simply be God. Amen. And the church said,
amen.
Amen. This is the evidence of true believers. These are your vital signs that shows Christ is real in your life.